The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship this morning. Today we will hear the prophet Isaiah proclaim that a young woman will have a son and name him Emmanuel, God with us. In the gospel reading, we will hear Matthew's account of the appearance of the angel to Mary and the birth of the one named Emmanuel. On this final Sunday of Advent, we prepare to celebrate the birth of the one born to save us. Let us worship together.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. Isaiah spoke to a people called Chosen, to a tribe called Israel, with a light of hope. Gabriel came to a town called Nazareth, to a girl named Mary, with a light of joy. Mary went to a place called Bethlehem, to a stable called a nursery, with a light of love. As we light our fourth Advent candle, we rejoice with Mary, for love has flesh. Come now, O child of Mary.
Come now, O Prince of Love.
Please join me in the prayer of the day. Eternal God of love and grace, who comes to us in surprising ways, in angel appearances, in defeat of enemies, and in resurrection from the dead. Show us the face of Emmanuel in our time. Bring us from fear to awe, we pray. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first hymn is number 347.
Thank you.
God comes to us just as we are, with all our triumphs, our worries, our gratitude, and our failures. We deepen our relationship with God now by drawing close and confessing our sins. Please pray with me. Shepherd of our souls, we anticipate your coming, but do not feel ready. We have done too much and not done enough. We have focused too much on ourselves and not enough on others. Problems large and small have distracted us from the hope you offer us, which is so much bigger than all that makes us afraid. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine, that we might be saved. Amen. Emmanuel did not come into the world to condemn, but to save. God does not come to imprison us, but to set us free. Through this abundant love, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. God of hope, who never lets us go, draw near to us in these ancient words. By your Holy Spirit, let us be filled, lifted up, and leveled as you prepare in our hearts the path of your coming. Amen. The first scripture reading is from the book of Isaiah, Chapter 7, verses 10 through 16. The background of this requires a little bit of knowledge of what goes on in Isaiah 7, 1 through 9. The king of Aram and the king of Ephraim, or the northern kingdom of Israel, were forming a coalition against Tiglath-Pileser, the king of Assyria. Assyria was the great and vengeful military power of the time. It was the last kingdom in the world you wanted to try to annoy. And they were going to go to war with Assyria. So King Ahaz of Judah was in what he considered a lose-lose proposition. He either joined the coalition and got the Assyrians mad at him, or he refused to join the coalition and would be overthrown by Aram and Ephraim. Isaiah came to him at the end of this, right before the passage we are going to read, and said, the message from God is to trust in him, to ignore the threat from Ephraim and Aram, because it will not affect you. Ahaz didn't believe this, as you will hear, and continues to refuse to believe that God is in control. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol, or high as heaven. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary mortals, that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child, and shall bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel. He shall eat curds and honey by the time he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the child knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land before whose two kings you are in dread will be deserted. The second reading is from the book of Romans, chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. Ancient letters started with a traditional formula. You had the person who's sending the letter saying who he is and indicating who the recipient of the letter should be. And we have this here, but in greatly expanded form. Paul uses the chance to announce who he is to basically give a praises of the message that will be in the rest of Romans. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, the gospel concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by resurrection from the dead. Jesus Christ, our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship, to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for the sake of his name, including yourselves, who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all God's beloved in Rome, who are called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you.
And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Perfect for this morning when we hear the gospel reading about Joseph, who doesn't say a word. And thank you to Warren for the introduction to the first reading from Isaiah, if only to hear the king's name, Tiglath-Pileser. What an ancient great name, although not a great king. The gospel reading comes from the gospel according to Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. And in this reading, we hear Matthew tell us about Isaiah's words becoming reality. Now, the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the young woman shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Poor King Ahaz. The prophet invites him to contemplate something genuinely new, and he just won't do it. He'd rather stick with what is sadly familiar. Talk of changing perspective is common in our culture. It's a cliche, though, worn out, tired, only experienced superficially. The myth behind changing one's perspective in our culture is that it is easy. There's a scene in the movie Dead Poets Society when the teacher, Robin Williams, is trying to help his students understand the importance of changing perspective, of seeing things in a different way that provides an insight. He vividly demonstrates this by jumping up on his desk in the front of the classroom. He looks around and then he looks at them and says, "Things look different from up here. Come and see." One after another, the students dutifully climb up on top of his desk and then quickly look around and then jump off, suspicious maybe that what they're doing is just not permitted. And so William scolds them and says, "Don't jump off like a bunch of lemmings. Look around." While the scene is very funny, it's also revealing. For although our culture loves to talk about changing perspectives, it so often does so like those students jumping off of the desk. Not enough time or energy or thought is given to engaging the change in perspective. Any insights that might have been gained are thus never realized, so that changing perspective becomes an exercise in changing one's physical location. Genuinely changing one's perspective is not easy. To do so physically might be easy enough, but to learn from that change, to internalize the insights that come with it mentally, philosophically, spiritually, is very difficult. A change in perspective that results in a change in the way that we think and believe and behave is some of the hardest work that one can find. What is a better way of saying it? Such a change feels like conversion, like salvation. Why does it feel that way? It feels that way because a change in perspective that leads to a new harmony, a new sense of rightness, and maybe of well-being, feels like balance. Like that balance you feel when you're first learning to ride a bicycle. You're no longer conscious of the effort to stay balanced. You just are. And it feels like gliding along, free and easy, where there used to be only a fear of falling. Suddenly there's an outward looking of the eyes and the question, where do I want to go? And then there's no looking back. Life is forever changed. That is what balance feels like. And that is what happens when you really change your perspective. When we are young and maturing, we seem to have many of these wonderful experiences of discovering a new balance. Some of the most important ones happen in our teenage years, when we finally realize who it is we want to be and are. Figuring out who you are is like discovering your gyroscope, the thing that helps you maintain your balance throughout your life. Once we reach maturity, however, those moments of discovering new balance become more and more infrequent. Having figured out who we are, we act as if experience can no longer affect us, as if the events in our lives don't bump us off course to one degree or another. Certainly, we readily admit that life can knock us for a loop. The pandemic has reinforced that truth. But when we're knocked off course, the balance that we seek to recover is not a new balance, but the old one. And to do so is to act as if the hard knock has never happened. Any navigator will tell you that plotting a course in that way is no way to go forward. Balance, then, is more than just feeling safe. It's also an awareness, a knowledge of where one really is. Since our tendency is to pay less attention to our lives as we live them, we tend to only feel half of our balance. We may have a routine, all may seem manageable, but we know less and less about where we actually are right now. Does it not need to be said that being in such a situation feels like being lost? What happens is that we feel increasingly unsure of ourselves. We might feel easily threatened, as if the least little thing will throw us off balance. We may feel like we're going to fall in one way or another. The Navajo have a great word for this, koyanasquatsi, life out of balance. Or as the writer Ed Abbey translates it, crazy weirdness, man. It's a word that works easily, equally well, to describe imbalance on large scales or on small ones. On a large scale, the manifestations of koyanasquatsi are legion. There are imbalances of power, of wealth, of understanding. From these imbalances come all sorts of downfalls: political powerlessness and exclusion, poverty, and all of the isms. Within the smaller contexts of our lives, the bumps and hard knocks we experience, the disorientation, all take a toll on our balance. Very often we're able to recover the old balance and force it. But what we fail to evaluate in a new way is our new location and heading, which is the result of the disorienting experience. All of those little, and sometimes not so small, course changes add up to the point where we stop ourselves at a certain place and wonder, where in the world am I? And where am I going? How often in conversation with someone have we heard another say, I don't know where I am, and I don't remember how I got here? The reason for the lostness is that only half of what makes for balance has been given any attention all along the way. Couple this with the effects of sin, the ways that we are broken, of bad decisions and unforeseen consequences, and we begin to approach what we mean when we talk about being lost. Hamlet says, early in Shakespeare's wonderful play, time is out of joint. O cursed spite that ever I was born to set it right. What we anticipate and celebrate in this Lenten season is the birth of the one who comes and who came to set things right, to restore the balance of creation. It's a balance that he holds within himself. Christ is the only one who bore within himself the balanced union of creation and divinity. It's a balance that we can realize by being in him, or as Paul wrote, by putting on Christ. Is that not the balance or the harmony that is the object of religion? The quest for a cosmic harmony, for peace, or for union with God, as the mystics talk about it? Is that not what we really want? The peace that passes all understanding. It is a peace, a harmony, a balance that we find in Christ. But putting on Christ requires a change in perspective. It requires a relocation of the center of our beings, making Christ the center of our lives. That is the way we recover that balance, the balance which God intended for us in remaking us in Christ's image. In the text that Warren read for us from Isaiah, we meet someone who is seeking balance. His name is Ahaz, the king of Judah. Ahaz has lost his peace. He's lost his cool. He's lost his balance. He's unsettled because two kings are threatening him and Judah. God realizes that Ahaz and the people are unsettled, and so God sends Isaiah to go and tell Ahaz and the people how they can find the comfort and the assurance that they are seeking. He then tells them that God will save, even in this political crisis. But knowing how conniving kings can be, Isaiah defiantly offers a challenge to Ahaz. Ask the Lord for a sign, even in the depths of Sheol or in the heights of heaven. And Ahaz, who gives the appearance of piety, refuses to put the Lord to the test, he says, but actually, he's not motivated by any piety. He's motivated by self-interest. For Ahaz knows that if he takes up the prophet's challenge and thus finds that what Isaiah says is valid, then Ahaz will be forced to revise his way of governing, to conform to the assurance offered by faith. So what we see is not an act of piety. It's rather an act of evasion. For Ahaz does not want to subject his rule to the claims of faith. He wants to maintain his independence. He's not willing to relinquish the old normal. He says, in essence, I know what is best. I just want God to authorize what I already have in mind. And Isaiah responds with the oracle that promises the coming of Emmanuel, the proof that Ahaz did not care to have comes anyway. The good news in the oracle is that the threat of the two kings that has so unsettled the people, it will pass. The bad news is that the passing of those two kings will lead to some bad days ahead for Ahaz and for his people. That news comes in the phrase at the end of verse 17, the king of Assyria. And that refers to the evil empire to the north of Judah, an empire that will prove to be brutal and ruthless, massive, and irresistible. All of that is ancient history for us. Because it is Advent, we know that the point of what Isaiah says is the innocent baby with the odd name. What Isaiah seeks to do is gather the entire fearful drama of public life and reorganize it around that baby, whose presence and whose name assert the necessity of justice and of righteousness, and that that baby become the center in the public arena. Isaiah seeks to relocate the center of the people's trust, and Ahaz and the people, they refuse. They trust instead in brute force. They want to trust in the power of their army and its weapons. Isaiah tells them that they had better trust in the care and the protection of the God who brought them out of the land of Egypt. There will be no lasting security in anything else. If God is not with the people, no amount of brute force will save them. What impresses me in those ancient words we have heard today is the passion with which God wants to act on behalf of the people. God is saying to them, dare me to prove that you are right, to trust me. Instead, the king's tiresome refusal to take up God's challenge guarantees that the king will maintain his foolish autonomy, and it guarantees as well his ultimate defeat and the brutal conquest of his kingdom and his people. He foolishly insists on an autonomy that cannot save him, and that insistence remains astonishing. So here we are on the other side of the birth of Emmanuel, and God's daring challenge remains. God remains eager to supply what we need. God passionately longs to come and settle us. Jesus said during his ministry, my own peace I give you. All that we have to do is believe and receive it. But how often, like Ahaz, do we present a pious front because we really don't want to pick up the gauntlet that God has thrown down? How often do we prefer our foolish autonomy and independence? How often do we insist on an old normal with its old balance that doesn't really work anymore, to a new balance that comes with a new perspective? That is the gift of God, which we can receive in faith. When we, like poor King Ahaz, refuse to accept God's challenge, we remain unsettled, trusting in what cannot save us. Now, whatever you may think of the doctrine of original sin, the truth in the doctrine is that we cannot save ourselves. We cannot find the balance that we seek on our own. There's no program that we can enroll in, no regimen that we can adopt that will do it for us. Only in Christ do we find what we seek. Only by placing Christ in the center of who we are will we know true peace, a comforting balance, and a lasting security. What would happen if the center of our lives was relocated so that the baby's presence became the central reality of our lives, of all that we are? We would experience again the intense balance of our conversions, for everything changes when God is with us. That is the change that Mary sang about and hoped for, and it is the change in which Joseph had faith, even in his silence. The good news for us is that Christ is coming again. In this season, we prepare for and make him room, and we look again into our hearts to see if his place is at the very center of who we are. If he is not the center, it's time to relocate the center. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen. I invite you to stand with me as we affirm our faith now by way of this passage from our confession of 1967. Out of Israel, God in due time raised up Jesus. His faith and obedience were the response of the perfect child of God. He was the fulfillment of God's promise to Israel, the beginning of the new creation, and the pioneer of the new humanity. He gave history its meaning and direction, and called the church to be his servant for the reconciliation of the world. Amen. Our hymn now is number 100. You may be seated. As we go to God together now in prayer, some of those we'll want to remember are named in the bulletin. We're praying for Lorraine Glossa, Harold and Lois Geither as they settle into their new place, for Marilyn Thies and Marilyn Dewey, for Ruth Crothers and Jonathan Kleppel, for Deborah Longacre, Wendy Smith, Kathy Troy, Sister Diane, Ann Mast-Catton, and Mike Kelly. And Cedar asks that we remember his father, John, who is in ICU after having emergency surgery. And so we ask for prayer for him as he begins his recovery. I can tell you that with Jonathan, I announced last Sunday, was due to have a drug court panel this past Monday that began, but they did not finish. And so we don't know yet what his outcome is going to be, but hopefully we'll know that tomorrow. So please do keep him in your prayers. Are there others we can remember today? Yes, thank you. The Scott Bennett family. Well, mindful of these then, let us go to God together in prayer, first in silence to offer our own intercessions and petitions, and then to respond together. Let us pray. As we come to the festival of Jesus' birth, let us pray that we hear God's word and clearly receive the faith God gives as we say together, O God, who is with us, hear our prayer. Holy God, who astonishes us with surprising gifts, we pray for your church, and for people of faith in every language and belief, that your wisdom will show us our common life, and that all people may rejoice in what you create. O God, who is with us, hear our prayer. Giver of the stars and planets, creator of rivers and oceans, and creatures large and small, we pray for wisdom as we live on and with your earth. Evoke in us awe for your goodness in these familiar surroundings, our hills and valleys, forests and lakes, that the powers you have placed here to move through soil and air will remind us always of your bounty and of your love. O God, who is with us, hear our prayer. Power above all powers, we pray for the leaders of governments in every nation, especially in Russia, Saudi Arabia, Iran, and our own nation, that they may have wisdom to choose what serves the common good. O God, who is with us, hear our prayer. Lover of all creation, we pray for all of those we too easily forget, those of your children who are poor or without a permanent address or in prison, those who are sick or lonely or frightened, all who hunger for faith and hope, especially today in Ukraine, Yemen, and Palestine. Care for them, that they may be strengthened by the joy known in your healing. O God, who is with us, hear our prayer. Holy God, in whose community we thrive, we pray for those with whom we share our daily lives, our families, our friends and neighbors, those with whom we work and play, those whose names we do not know who provide for us, that all may be renewed in courage and nurtured in hope. O God, who is with us, hear our prayer. Sustainer of your people, we give you thanks for members of the body of Christ in every age and every place, who, by their witness, bring us here today. Come to us in Christ, O God, that we who live in this world by faith may see that faith confirmed in the world to come, through the risen one who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lauren Smith had planned to bring us a good word about mission this morning as a moment for mission, but tested positive on Wednesday or Thursday this week. So for herself and for us, she's not here today. So all that we have is the Lord's. All that we may become and receive is in God's hands. For the sake of the joy that is ours, when our bonds grow deep with others, let us give generously now for the well-being of the world. You may do so as the usher passes among you this morning, or you may continue to send in your contributions through the mail or use the donate button on the church's website. Let us give.
Holy God, you bless us with many gifts. You retrieve us from despair and fear. You visit us with surprising proclamations, and you intend for us good things. We thank you for your steadfast love, for sending signs of assurance, and for the gift of faith. Use our gifts and offerings to bring comfort and justice to those in need, reforming the ways of our world for the sake of new life. Amen. Please join me in the prayer of saving promise. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
It is good to see you all on this cold morning. Preachers wonder sometimes when it gets cold if people will keep coming, and you are here, so good to see you all. I know with me you thank Warren for helping to lead us in worship, and thank you to Cedar and to Brett who managed unseen challenges this morning. We came to church this morning and there was no internet. So I think we had a live stream anyway, thanks to Brett's phone. So thank you for that. I'll get the recording posted tomorrow. There are a few announcements to highlight. The nearest one is what's happening this afternoon. We hope you can come back at 4 o'clock to hear beautiful, beautiful music. Barkey Bryant's going to be here with his trio to play. We'll sing together, we'll pray together, and we'll remember those we have lost in the year that is past. Also note that we will be here on Christmas Eve in person, but on Christmas Day, we will be online only. So if you remember how we did things during the pandemic, we joined together on Zoom, and then I'll start a recorded service, which we'll watch together. So on Christmas morning, it'll be a briefer service of worship, what we normally do as Presbyterians, known as morning prayer. It'll be about a half hour, 35 minutes, and then we can visit together after that. And then on Sunday, January 1st, we'll also be online only. It'll be largely a hymn sing. We won't enjoy each other's presence as we do that, but we'll sing many good Christmas carols on that day. So Christmas Day, online only, January 1st, online only, and then January 8th, we'll be back in person. So two more I'd like to thank before we go are Seungah and Pyunghwa. Thank you so much. As being where we are, so close to a university with a fabulous music program, we get to hear the future. Sometimes we get to hear the present too. So thank you very much. And thank you to James for lighting our fourth Advent candle this morning. So, I'm sorry? A swing dance? Yep, that's in the bulletin? Yeah, so. So I say that because sometimes we are asked questions about announcements that are in the bulletin. So yes, swing dance tonight. Don't forget that as well. Lots of opportunities that await us. So as you go forth now, go forth in the power of the Holy Spirit to love and serve the Lord in all that you do. And would you bow for the benediction? Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face smile upon you and be gracious unto you. May God give you grace never to sell yourself short, grace to risk something big for something good, grace to remember that the world is now too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So may God take your minds and think through them. May God take your lips and speak through them. May God take your hearts and set them on fire. Through Jesus our Savior, amen.